long day, so we'll wrap this up early so that you can get on with your awards. Okay. The thing is, they asked me to moderate this session, and I was like, yeah, I am not a PR guy. They asked me to be part of the jury, and I was like, I am not a PR guy. I don't belong to this industry. I'm a completely creative guy. But when I was seeing the entries for the awards, it was very, very surprising to, and that's why I understand why they brought me into the matrix. The kind of digital work that we saw, there were some great ideas, there was some precision-driven execution, but what we didn't get to see is any great digital drive or digital idea. And I'm completely aware that everything can't be digital when you are trying to influence policy. But we would have loved to see execution a little bit better. And here's a little tip for all those who have submitted entries and would submit entries next year. Try to make your presentation also digital friendly. I think we have passed the age of doing PPT presentations and sticking newspaper articles onto your PPT presentations. Don't do that. There were many guys who might have got a slight advantage also is because they presented their case very well. And they did good videos, and they were very clear in their communication. And I think it all goes with the fact that we are, of course, talking about PR and communications, right? So I think what we lacked is a little bit more on aggression on digital when the whole world is shifting to digital. And I think we'll just take 25, 30 minutes to understand exactly where that shift is and are you missing out on it? Because trust me, I work in the digital space and I can tell you the kind of returns, the 10x, 100x returns you can get on digital is phenomenal compared to the money that you put in digital. All you need is great execution and thought. You don't need a platform, you don't need to pay, you don't need to push. All you need is that. And I think we have, and I've been having this conversation with all of the panelists, it's some very, very interesting thoughts. And I'd like to start with Shruti. You know, we were just talking about corporates and the strategy that they had. Just let's take first and foremost, how important is digital? Let's get that fact first into play. Is digital indispensable? Is it a 50-50? And you know, we can't even look too far into the future also. The rules are changing every six months. So 6 months to a year maximum, where is digital? Where are we falling short? And how do you see it happening?
As I understand, nothing is indispensable in this world, right? And same stands for digital. Or for the matter, print as well as television. How strong digital is today is known by the fact of the amount that any one of us here in this room today spend on the internet, on the digital medium. Be it a Facebook, be it Twitter, be it just going online to WhatsApp, chat, do anything of that matter, right? You are spending a considerable amount of time on digital. So you cannot defy the fact that digital does not exist in the country or digital does not exist in your mind. That's not possible. What depends, what's more important to understand is how important that effect of digital is in our lives, right? And we cannot defy the fact again that print and television do not exist. As much as digital exists, so do print and television. You cannot do without either, but you cannot do without being available on the digital medium. If today you go and tell me that only do a print advertisement or only do television, I will probably become non-existent in the eyes of 90% of the population who is online 80% of the time in the day. When you get up in the morning, you want to look at your phone. When you sleep in the night, you want to look at your phone. That's all you do. You take major...
You were mentioning, I think that was the most fabulous aspect that you were mentioning, is that even now on television and print, we know when we are consuming an ad.
Right.
I mean, I do digital all through the day, but it was, you know, I was not looking at it from that perspective. Yeah. Is that when I'm scrolling through a timeline...
You don't look at the ads, do you? I mean, unless and until you're looking for an advertisement specifically, does your mind actually rack you to look at a sponsored post or a paid partnership? Do you really pay attention to those things that the brand is spending? You don't. But as a consumer, you're still consuming that. You don't realize it as a consumer that you're consuming that, but at the back of your mind, you're seeing it. It's there for you. It's available for you. At some point of time or the other, it is a consumption that you're doing at the back of your mind. When you go to make your offline purchase, you don't realize how that online view of a particular ad or something that you just scrolled through or something that you saw in an article that you were reading on a video that you just passed through, which might have impacted
right.
your actual purchase decision or your actual buying decision, right? So you don't really realize that on the face of it as a consumer, because we still don't want to accept the fact that we've moved away from the so-called, and I will call it so-called, traditional media, which is print and television. Mm. As a brand, I am not wanting to or willing to, and I'll talk about a lot of brands together.
Okay.
As a brand, we are not willing to yet leave everything else and go completely digital, even though majority of our population is consuming media, is consuming advertisements online. So that's...
So are you then also admitting to the fact that there would be some sort of legacy mindset that is there in the spenders?
It's always there.
Do you think this is to be done?
You tell me, and that's exactly what we were talking, right? It's a simple fact of I will have a budget defined, right? For any kind, and as a brand, I'll have a budget defined for something that I want to spend on digital, something that I want to spend on the other mediums of communication to reach my consumers, right? You will spend more on a medium where you know your consumer is. But are you really doing that? Your consumer is digital today. Your consumer is majorly consuming all social media platforms today. But are you still spending majority of your budget to communicate with the consumer there? You're not, because okay. traditionally you're aligned with the fact of wanting to do print, of wanting to do TV, because at the back of your mind you know that unless you do that, they will not recognize you.
Sure.
They will miss you.
Rachana, you know, from B2C to B2B, I'm a novice in this. Please explain this to me. I spend my life doing sort of B2C because I do content creation,
yeah.
which is basically B2C. But on B2B, would you then say that digital is still important? Is because then you have to do targeting. You have to be very specific to who you're reaching out. How important is digital in B2B?
See, this is the power of digital. It's analytics, which we want to highlight in all our conversations, which is not that intensive when it comes to traditional media. So analytics in digital drives the campaign. Its success factors are defined. Your targeting is defined. And you are not limited to any geography. When it comes to B2B, you may probably have customers across the world. And we are referring to most of the enterprise technology firms. I mean, most of the companies today are doing businesses abroad. I mean, 60-80% of their numbers are outside of India. They want to reach out to probably a particular profile of people. You know, I want to only reach the finance heads across manufacturing, chemicals, automobile, etc. That is only possible by going deeper and deeper into digital. You cannot do that micro-targeting on a mass platform.
Shruti was saying that I can't let go of print and television while I know that it is digital. You're pure play digital. So you have let print and television go.
Yeah,
and you're okay with that.
We are completely okay with that. A, the analytics, which plays a very powerful role in the entire roadmap of the campaign. Second, you go very deep in your content. You can really advance your content because you know the, you know, 100, maybe the audience size you're targeting are exactly understanding what you're writing or what you want them to communicate, which at a broader level or a mass media, you cannot go deep. So the mass media stories are quite shallow when it comes to focusing them on digital. You can go very deep on your content. So that's the second big edge on digital. And the third, of course, is you can play videos. You can. So the way to express that content again goes very, you know, you really have multiple ways to express that creativity.
Mm.
And the fourth biggest advantage is there is no limitation on your word count or on your placement, etc., which we really find
all the kind of
all
content
the time,
you
know, in that 30 seconds, in that 20 second slot on a mainstream media, you are struggling to communicate. What can you communicate in the 10, 20, 30 seconds?
Okay.
But here you have the opportunity to go deep, drive, talk about research, talk about your analytics, and you can actually establish your message in a much clearer manner.
Surya, from a technical side in life, you've gone towards digital content strategy. You're looking at the creative aspect of things. We've talked about the platform. Let's talk about creativity, because I mean, I'm a little more comfortable in that genre because we are digital content creators. How important is it? Because, you know, in the traditional format, the delivery platform really mattered. If I have a big delivery platform, I can go a little soft on the content creation also because I already have a captive audience. How does that play completely change in digital? How does the strategy change from print and television into digital? How is it different? And may I also ask you, are we still in that zone ki acha television or print ka utha diya aur digital mein chhap diya?
No, I think that's a very good question, actually, because I think we need to plan for channel-specific outcomes, right? And what we're getting with, let's say, a TikTok is very different from the type of engagement that you'd get on a Facebook, for example. So, along with every channel, you're getting different means of telling different stories, right? And which is why the creative aspects also change. Attention spans are probably at the lowest levels. You've got 5 seconds to make an impact in terms of grasping that consumer and then go on to tell a longer story if you can captivate them. So no matter how you sort of want to send out your message, you have to plan for the channel first because you want to look at your audiences and where they are and what they're talking about. Today, I think there was a good point about how even B2B is using digital and how focused they can be. And I completely second your point. I mean, it would take me 10 minutes to find out all the Twitter users in India who are interested in, let's say, artificial intelligence. And I can even go down to the level of actually understanding all the conversations that they're having. So if I want to make a statement and if I want to, you know, sort of cordon them into a different area of conversations, then I have the means for doing that. How I would tell a story, of course, and we've heard it through the conference, creativity is absolutely essential because it's the way that you tell the story, right? There has to be a twist in the story. So frankly, storytelling is absolutely critical, but how you tell the story in what format and what channel you're using to reach out to your audience is at the heart of our campaigns.
Sure. Shruti, you know, and I, for the benefit of the audience, you know, one is theory, the other is practice. And I always want the audience to walk away richer in sort of understanding how things have worked. I want you to be very specific in telling us what are the success stories in digital content, storytelling on the digital platform, on social media platforms, what has worked so that they can say, acha, ye wala example tha, let's see how we can build on that. What would your perfect or most successful example be in the last year?
So I'll tell you an example from Ford itself. And we've had this problem with the consumer mindset that Ford is not a trustworthy brand because of the parts are expensive, the service is expensive. And we've actually picked that up and built on a campaign through the last 3 years, which was called a Ford Family Wali Feeling. That campaign, we have mostly and actually, I would say 90% resonated with and done on digital medium. Apart from that, what we've also done on digital big time, and that's that's purely digital. We've hardly done anything print and television on that. We've done videos, we've done social content, all in context with building the service price promise and also telling you that how the service of Ford is actually cheaper and not as expensive as the mindset has been so far.
Okay.
So much so of giving transparency to go and check your price online.
Okay.
And that's been a pure campaign that we've built only on digital by building the digital videos. And we've reached a stage where we have consumers now voicing their own opinions when people come up with concerns online. And, you know, we have communities online and there are some people who will come up with concerns saying, you know, I think Ford service is expensive and it's extra chargeable. And you can be a moderator, you can be a part of the groups, right? And observe the conversations. And we get to see where people who are fans actually come out and say that, no, you know, go and visit here.
Interesting.
Go see, this is my bill from the last service. It's not as such. Contrary to until 3 years ago, this was not the case.
Sure.
So this time has really helped us build the promise and the trust that we've been able to build in the consumers purely through the digital media.
When your customers become your brand ambassadors, I think
that's the biggest success.
Okay, so yeah.
For me, I mean, looking beyond the lens of campaign particularly, but if I look at a service that's come up in the last
year... I'm saying story, success story. It could be a campaign or it could be...
So, as a product or service, I'd say in the edtech space, what Byju's has done is fantastic. I mean, imagine the market for it. We recently did a study that was across 25 countries for a particular client, and we are looking at what the youth have to say or how should they be positioned and prepared for the future. Reskilling is something that is absolutely critical in many of these countries put together. So a platform like Byju's and how it sort of exploited the edtech space, I think the quantum of people who have moved on to the platform and used that platform, it's fantastic. And I think the way forward is very bright and promising when it comes to a platform like edtech. And we're going to see more of this. I mean, some of the topics that we were talking about today, AI, intelligence, and the quantified self is really something that's not very far away. I mean, there's a lot of people out here who are uploading their data and stats on how the human body behaves. So imagine the possibilities that you get in healthcare as an outcome. And when we say digital, I think we have to look beyond the lens of just communicating out there. And as it was rightly pointed out, that the quantum of data that's available to us from a measurement perspective is increasing rapidly. And with more sensors out there, it's going to explode. Imagine 5G coming in. You'll know the whereabouts of your car, you'll know road conditions, and you'll get distinct, let's say, insurance programs made for every trip that you take. So telematics and everything is just a stone's throw away.
That's not because already the bell is going off. Not only B2C as a success story, and also because you are pure play digital, so I think that question should also go to you, is that how much has been done, or are we really behind? From an international perspective also,
sure.
Where are we?
I'm just coming to that. So a very simple example, in fact, we've been doing many campaigns across the world. So North America is fully covered by us, that is US, Canada. Middle East, Africa is a big campaign. I mean, a lot of companies from India marketing all the time. Southeast Asia is purely covered by us. Asia Pacific is covered by us. One of the campaigns, since we are talking of a success factor, I mean, I'm saying as targeted. There was a medical tourism story, which was particularly meant to only penetrate Uzbekistan. Now tell me, this is the power of only going digital. So we could take the campaign, successfully get it published in Uzbekistan portals. And the campaign was successful. I mean, it was a tie-up of some government, et cetera, health ministry tie-up, but the target was purely only plugged this in Uzbekistan. So that was a beautiful thing. And like that, we do many stories which are very, very specific to countries or regions. And that place, there was another one.
Where do we compare internationally?
Where
does India compare internationally?
See, there are a lot of mandates for India, time and again, from companies who are sitting abroad and targeting India.
Yeah.
Quite many stories. And from India, when we want to send stories abroad.
So okay. So, before we are completely booted out.
Thank you. Yeah, we are all.
Completely out of time. But ladies and gentlemen, I can at least assure you of this, is that the kind of entries that we saw, great ideas, great potential, a lot of great execution, but trust me, the focus on digital is a little less. And next year, when we perhaps might be sitting here, I think there would be a lot more digital focus, digital action for sure. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.